Mr. President, last night, between 6 and 7 o'clock, I did a telephone town hall meeting back to Georgia. We had a little over 3,000 people on the call, and I was able to handle 16 questions. As I listened to the answers that I was giving to the questions, I was struck by what a real problem we have in Washington. Washington is making things worse. Georgians are frightened for their job, the value of their home, the education of their children. They're uncertain about everything, and as you give them answers about what's happening in Washington, you realize Washington is making it worse. And I want to give a couple of examples based on my experiences. First of all, let's talk about legislation for a second. You know, we have high unemployment, 9.1%, high unemployment. We have people without jobs or underemployed. And we have a law in the United States called the Workforce Investment Act, WIA. I'm on the subcommittee that oversees it, in the Education Committee. We've basically had an agreement on the expansion and the reauthorization for the Workforce Investment Act for months, but yet it languishes in committee because there are arguments over labor provisions that want to be added to it. Here we are with 9.1% unemployment, a nation that's in trouble, and we can't pass the Workforce Investment Act that's intended to help address the very problem that we have. Secondly, I'm on the Health, Education, Labor, and Pension Committee that does the reauthorization of the Elementary and Secondary Education Act, the fundamental foundation of training and improving our kids for the jobs of the 21st century. It's gone 4 years without reauthorization and languishes in committee today because of inattention or a lack of a willingness to bring it forward. So our children remain educated and taught and motivated under a law that's now been expired for almost 5 years. That's just not right. At a time we should be educating our children, at a time we should be training workers, we in Washington are doing nothing. On the Commerce Committee that I serve on, we're over the FAA Committee, the reauthorization of the Federal Aviation Administration, critical to economic development. That conference committee continues to languish, and what are the arguments about? More often than not, about changes in labor laws. We need to get the job done in Washington, D.C. We need to go to work. We need to understand the American people are in trouble, they're hurting, and our job is to provide answers, not to make it worse. I want to talk about a second feature. I want to talk about regulation for just a second. Or strangulation, if you will. I've told this story once on the floor. I want to tell it again. January 3rd, this year, I was at the OK Cafe in Buckhead for breakfast to meet a couple of businessmen. I walked in the front door, and Steve Hennessy of Hennessy Cadillac Land Rover, a big automobile dealer in Atlanta, called my name out and went running across the restaurant floor. I thought he was going to give me a bear hug. Instead, he put his index finger on my chest. And he said, "Johnny, yesterday I fired a salesman and hired two compliance officers. This financial re-regulation bill and the Dodd-Frank bill is strangling my productivity and raising my cost of doing business." And I think we do have to recognize that regulation has consequences. It is not our job to eliminate risk in the marketplace. It is our job to mitigate risk so people will take risk in terms of seeking reward, which is what the capitalistic system is based on. Talk about a few other regulations that are causing significant problems in our recovery. The qualified residential mortgage rule that's being promulgated now by the six regulators will, if it goes into effect on August the 1st, they've now put the effective date off, probably constrict the real estate market, which is already suppressed by 70%, by another 40%, because it's basically going to take capital and risk capital and credit away from the very Americans who are, in fact, buying homes today. In fact, in order to mitigate risk and try and eliminate it, it requires lenders hold 5% risk retention until a loan matures. It says you can't loan anybody less than 80%, or more than 80%, and if you have anything more than 80%, you can't even have a private mortgage insurance policy to guarantee the money. So you're going to flood every buyer left to where? To FHA, which is exempt from the Dodd-Frank bill, or Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac, which are going out of business, which is going to mean you're shifting more and more of the burden of mortgage financing on people that are already overstressed. Regulatory intent should not do that. My farmers, my dairy farmers in Georgia, are looking at a rule now where milk is being categorized as a hazardous substance, where it's going to have to be contained in tanks and reservoirs that now meet the standards of petroleum. Higher investment, but with no additional profit from the company. That's protracted. Water. The EPA wants to take navigable out in front of the word water in terms of the Clean Water Act so the government doesn't regulate just navigable waters, but it regulates every water. And credit. Credit is becoming non-existent for Main Street. I'm a small business guy. I was in small business in Georgia for 33 years. A lot of small business people use their credit cards to manage their cash flow over time. Because of the credit bill that was passed a couple of years ago, they don't have the flexibility to do that anymore. Bank credit is suspended primarily because a lot of banks are in fact being run by the FDIC under cease and desist orders. Or if they are extending credit alone, they're only extending credit to the extent a borrower can put that much money in the bank. And when you constrict credit, you suppress small business. When you suppress small business, you suppress 72% of the employment in the United States of America. But now last, and I want to commend Senator Corker for his remarks about an hour ago on the floor, because he focused on the big problem that we have, and that's debt and deficit. And it's kind of disappointing to me that we spent more time on the SBA Act, which has been pulled now, it was on the floor beginning of last month, than we spent on all the Appropriations Acts in the last 3 years of this Congress. We debated amendments, we protracted the debate, but nothing happened. We ought to be talking about debt reduction, deficit reduction, and a long-term plan over time to amortize the debt of this country to a reasonable level. We have a debt ceiling vote that's confronting us, and I've heard the political statements made by people in both parties where there's a game of chicken being played right now. Some saying we're going to push it right up till August the 2nd, force a vote. If we don't get it, we'll run the risk of America's credit going up in cost and uncertainty happening. Others saying we're not going to do anything on a debt ceiling increase period until we have to at the last minute. That's not the way to run a business. That's not the way to expand your credit. That's not the way to run a country. We ought to be sitting around the kitchen table of Washington, D.C. and the United States Senate, reprioritizing the way we spend money to begin to rein in our expenditures, lower our deficit, and lower our debt. Mr. President, Madam President, I'll bet you every family in North Carolina, like every family in Georgia, has had in the last couple of years to sit around their kitchen table, reprioritize their expenditures. Things have changed. Their nest egg may have shrunk. Their equity may be suppressed. Their job may be in trouble. I've had to do it. Almost everybody in America. Why doesn't the American government do it? Why don't we, at a crisis moment of $14 trillion in debt with no ceiling above it, why don't we, with a deficit of $1.5 trillion, $300 billion more than discretionary spending, why aren't we sitting around that kitchen table? When I answered the questions last night on the teletown hall meeting, it became patently clear to me that Washington is making things worse. The American people want confidence that we will address the debt problem and the deficit problem and that we're working on it, not that we're putting it off to a drop-dead date and going to play chicken politics in the United States Senate. People want they don't mind regulation that's fair, but they mind regulation that's oppressive and actually suppresses jobs. They don't mind having acts in Washington being debated on the floor one way or another, depending on your position, but to leave them to languish in committee and not even bring them up, that's just not right. So my challenge for me and for every member of the Senate, for this administration and for the President, it is time for us to lead. We have a clock that's winding down on a debt ceiling increase that's going to be important for this country. But without substantial reform of the way we do our business, without a game plan for a down payment on our debt and deficit, without an indication that we're going to work together and have shared sacrifice, then there's nothing at all that we can do in this government except cause things to be worse. And I don't want to be a part of that. My last comment is this. I was 39 years old in 1983. A report was put out by the board of the Social Security Administration saying it was going broke in 2004. President Reagan and Tip O'Neill got together and said, we can't let that happen. President Reagan said, I don't want it to go broke, but I'm not going to raise the tax. Tip O'Neill said, I don't want it to go broke, but I'm not going to cut the benefit. And they went to the actuaries and they said, what do we do? The actuaries said, put out the eligibility. And so they changed the law and said, if you're an American born after 1943, you can't get Social Security at 65. You got to wait till you're 66. I'm 66. They put my Social Security off a year. I didn't miss it. They also made Social Security actuarially sound until 2050. And only in the last 2 years has that date come down. And it's come down because of unemployed Americans at age 62 taking discounted early Social Security and putting more pressure on the system. We could fix Social Security tomorrow just like they did in 1983 and not take a penny away from anybody, but move the eligibility out to be more reflective of life expectancy. And I know Medicare is the big political football, and I know everybody would like to say, well, the Republicans are trying to kill Medicare, and the Democrats love to say we're trying to protect it. Heck, I want to protect it. I got 9 grandchildren. The rest of my life is about those grandchildren. I want to see to it they have a country as free, as productive, as safe, and the benefits there for them that have been there for me. It's important that we save Medicare, but we can't save it by looking the other way. We can't save it by taking it off the table. We can't demonize a Democrat or a Republican for making a constructive decision to save Medicare. Instead of trying to make it the political issue of the 2012 election, we ought to make it the personal issue of each United States senator. Sit around that kitchen table, work together, and try and find a meaningful solution to a problem that saves Medicare for our future generations and also doesn't cause an escalation in our debt and our deficit. We are capable of doing it, but we have not demonstrated a will to do it. I challenge my colleagues to do the same thing. And I challenge my colleagues to do one other thing. Hold a telephone town hall sometime in the next couple of weeks. Talk to 3,500 of your citizens in your state. Listen to the questions that they're asking. They're scared, they're worried, and they're threatened. And Washington is making it worse.